What is it?
Fit, you know, for sure. But I'm a big believer in that.
The biggest celebrities on our TV screens today are a savvy bunch of personalities with multi-million-pound contracts. With backgrounds as diverse as modelling, football and children's television, or even a fleeting appearance on a reality show, a star can come from literally anywhere.
Normal people would watch entertainers on the telly. Now entertainers sit at home and watch normal people on the telly.
It's easier to get in, make a killing, be rubbish, and then move on to something else.
But the biggest stars in entertainment history are the all-round entertainers.
I'm an entertainer, I'm a performer, I'm an all-rounder, I do so many things.
I don't just do that. If you want me to act, I'll act. If you want me to be serious, I'll be serious.
The adrenaline goes and the lights shine and the eyes shine and they're on there.
Stop crying, we all love you, I'll call you later. Bye.
There's no limits.
These are unique individuals who live to entertain.
They're on his feet!
Can you ride a horse? Oh, yeah, of course. I'm not a horse. No way, you know. Can you roller skate? Yes, of course. That I can do.
Just tell me which part of the song you want me to jiggle me bits and I'll do it.
Unfortunately, you don't get many shows today where performers can go on and strut their stuff.
Hold on! Bill Forsyth?
Hello!
Found! Come on down!
After the death of Variety, these entertainers became the hosts of choice for the biggest money spinner on TV, the game show.
She's for the match!
I don't blame people for calling me a game show legend, but I do regret doing so many game shows.
This is going to be my very, very last series of Blind Date.
Tonight, we're going to discover just how these all-rounders have stayed at the top of the showbiz tree for over 70 years. The golden age of the all-round entertainer happened back when Britain was at war. During our darkest hour, the all-rounders were the country's secret weapon. One of the biggest names was Vera Lynn, who worked her way up from the music hall to become the Force's sweetheart.
Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.
Another star was cheeky Cockney comic Tommy Trinder.
The lives a man can lead, there's none that's like a
sailor. He had worked the country's music hall circuit for 18 years before landing the leading role of cheering up the troops.
You unlucky people. You know the beginning of an MGM film where Leo the Lion comes out and goes, bleh. Came out at the beginning of my picture, but he didn't roar. Just went.
Trinder was a great professional. He was a snappy, sharp, never lost for words comic in the really old tradition.
I said, if the Germans capture me, they're entitled to shoot me.
It wasn't one laugh every three and a half minutes for them. It was three and a half laughs every 1 minute.
Didn't know it meant all.
Thanks to the war, the all-round entertainers were almost national treasures.
How are you, George? I've come out to sing for you lads. Do you want a song now?
No, our singers want it clean as yours, won't
they? OK. I go into cleaning to earn an honest bob. For a nosy parker, it's an interesting job. Now it's a job that just suits me. A window cleaner you would be if you can see what I can see.
When I'm cleaning windows,
honeymooning couples too. You should see them villain coo. You'd be surprised at things they do.
When I'm cleaning windows.
After the war, hundreds of wannabe entertainers flocked to the cabaret clubs in London Soho looking for their shot at stardom.
I got the most wonderful excitement. He told me he'd pay me £36 a week. And up to then, I'd only got 10 or 12. And I thought, 36? My goodness. And then I thought, wait a minute, I'm doing 36 shows a week. It's only £1 a show, isn't it, really?
You did get propositioned. I never understood why. And when I look back at it, I didn't have any clothes on.
I wasn't a nude, but I was scantily dressed. And I was 17 by now. And I remember staring at these nude girls, and I just thought, how do they just walk around with no clothes on?
There were some lovely girls there. Yes, I was very lucky. Yes, of course, it was a very exciting and very enjoyable period of my professional life.
The Windmill Theatre was famous for being the sauciest show in town. And an army of ordinary men would queue round the block to see the dancing girls.
You used to see queues of these sort of quite sad men in long macs.
They were waiting for the famous fan dance, which featured, shockingly for its time, a semi-naked lady.
And you could see all these men masturbating in the audience. It was brilliant.
We weren't working to a normal audience. It was an all-male audience who'd queued up in the morning, and they could stay for six shows if they wanted to.
So making the Windmill audience laugh was never going to be easy.
In between the dancing and the singing and all that sort of thing, they had a different act on.
This is going to be a bit tricky because, you see, I am a comedian.
Those acts would have to do six shows a day.
This fellow was always in, every day, in the front row. And on about the third house of the fourth day, I forgot, I dried. Just couldn't remember what was next, and this fellow said, you tell the one about the parrot next. So I thought, thank you very much.
You walk out there, and some of them pick up their newspapers and start to read. Now, you try and make an audience who's heard your act already, who's now reading the newspaper, try and get through to them and make them laugh.
When you've died six times a day for 7 weeks, when you know, when you really know that you're not really wanted there and you're not really getting all the laughs you think you could be getting or should be getting, to still be able to keep your composure and deliver the lines cleanly, you know, that is very good training indeed.
While the Windmill launched the careers of numerous stars, it famously turned down others, including Norman Wisdom. Undeterred, this classic all-round entertainer continued to ply his trade, and by 1954, Norman Wisdom was top of the bill at the London Palladium.
I was in the London Palladium, which is the finest theatre in, almost the finest theatre in the world.
When he came on, the audience just screamed.
I was doing comedy and jokes and...
He was like a pop star.
Singing, dancing, tap dancing.
There's an all-round entertainer.
Every time the record says, I love you, it simply means, my darling, that I love you.
I'm not kidding you. I remember I had tears coming out of my eyes, although I was smiling and laughing, and it was so wonderful.
Norman Wisdom was just one of hundreds of stars represented by the Grade organisation. Founded by three Russian immigrant brothers, Lou, Leslie and Bernard, the organisation built a showbiz empire from poverty-stricken beginnings. They became the godfathers of the entertainment industry.
They were in every part of show business where money could be made and a gamble could be taken.
They were entertainment in the 50s.
If the Grades happened to come into the room, you just kept quiet. You didn't dare speak to them.
Those people were gods. I mean, they could point their finger and go, I think she should do the next show. You know, you were so grateful.
The most ambitious of the three was eldest brother Lou, an ex-Charleston dancer who gambled everything on a new venture, commercial television.
They were gamblers. And, you know, if you gamble in show business and you get it right, you're a genius. And if you gamble in show business and get it wrong, you're bankrupt.
Lou Grade's bid was successful. And in 1954, the BBC's 20-year monopoly was over. and ATV was launched.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4.
Lord Reith, the founding father of the BBC, predicted this new channel would be a premeditated orgy of vulgarity. Finally, the masses got what they needed. Pure, unadulterated entertainment. And when there was nothing else to do on a Sunday but go to church, Lou Grade gave them appointment-to-view TV at its best, Sunday night at the Palladium. But the Grades needed a star name to host the show and booked the people's favourite, Tommy Trinder.
Good evening, everybody. How do you do? Look what I've picked up. Cyril, have you had bookmakers on this stage? It's not warm. It must have been dropped last night. Liberace's.
That was the iconic show that changed the whole tone of television. Here was not only vaudeville, American headliners, but a game show with a jackpot in the middle.
The BBC were being beaten to the effect of 70% of the audience was watching ITV and 30% was watching the BBC.
Most people who had a television would be there for Sunday night at the London Palladium. That was their big opportunity to see the big stars that were booked on the show.
Trinder may have been a popular host with the public, but behind the scenes, he was making enemies.
Well, here it is, ladies and gentlemen, Beat the Clock, in which we invite members of the audience onto the stage, try and beat the clock and win some very valuable prize. I won't tell the rules and regulations, you know them.
Tommy Trinder was a genuinely unlikable man.
He used to have a go at the Greys and Val Parnell, you know, all the bosses, they're mean, or they're... And they told him to stop doing that. And he said, don't you tell me what to do.
Mrs. Heinzen, I don't know whether they play a game in Italy called Tip Cat. I know they play a game called Tip the Waiter. But...
You don't quite care who you offend or if you ever go, but, you know, it was a very cruel delivery, I think.
And they fired him.
That's it, let everybody see you. Oh, makes me look so pretty.
He never got another ITV show. So they can make or break you. Oh, yes.
After 3 years in charge, Trinder was replaced with a much younger all-round entertainer.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Sunday night at the London Palladium.
The minute he walked on the stage, you knew he was home. He was absolutely right for the show.
The difference, really, between Tommy Trinder and Bruce Forsyth is Trinder was a fantastic, stylish comedian. Bruce Forsyth is as well, but he is also, in addition, a wonderful dancer, a fantastic singer, and a fine actor, which a lot of people don't realise.
Forsyth was ambitious for stardom, and he took every opportunity to showcase his all-rounder talents.
He became known as comic compere, but then the tap dancing came in, he could tap dance. Then the piano playing came in and he could play the piano. So when he had guests on that could do that, he said, can I do a duet with you? Oh, Bruce Forsyth, and that's why I say he's an all-round entertainer.
Here he comes now. First, you look smashing. Where did you get all that Chinese gear?
I was in Chu Chin Chow.
Well, what did you play?
I played the chin.
Sunday night at the London Palladium was the vehicle to launch anybody's career. You could go onto the Palladium and you knew we were going to get 15, 20 million people watching it. And the next day, people would be saying, did you see so-and-so on the Palladium last night?
Capitalising on the success of his new television station, Lou Grade set his sights on Hollywood.
They were able to offer artists work in their theatres, and television exposure, and the television exposure filled the theatres, and so on and so on.
The competition was did they want to work for the BBC with all that in kind of involved, who had a big radio presence and everything else like that, or did they want to work for ITV, which paid twice the money the BBC paid? I mean, it's a very, very simple equation.
Top of ATV's wish list was America's greatest all-round entertainer in the 1950s, Sammy Davis Jr.
Ah, Sammy Davis. Fantastic performer.
I thought perhaps I might become an honorary supreme if you folks don't mind. No.
Sure.
He was the all-round entertainer of all time. He can sing, he can dance, he does impressions.
When you turn around the other way...
He worked with all the great American variety artists, and he took a little bit of that, and he took a little bit of that.
Somewhere along the way...
Mind if I come in?
You might guess. The friends we used to know...
But to become as proficient at your profession as Sammy Davis did, and the things he could do for, you know, go on stage for 3.5 hours, I personally think is a bit self-indulgent, but I mean, because I like to do as little as possible. Why, the lady
is a Sammy Davis's first appearance at the Royal Variety Show in London caused a sensation.
We had never, ever seen energy like it. He just took the entire show by the scruff of the neck and worked at such a pace and with such energy and such dynamism that it revolutionised light entertainment.
Lou Grade's ATV had the money to get him for a TV special. A young choreographer, Lionel Blair, was asked to do a dance routine with him.
It was a hat shop routine where I was a very snooty salesman and he was the ugly American.
Oh, good morning, sir. What could we do for sir?
What could we what?
What could we do for sir?
Oh, you're here by yourself? You got a group with you.
And then he showed me some steps, which I learnt, and he said, we'll finish with that. I went, all right. The most wonderful reviews. This has made Lionel Blair a star and all that. I didn't work for 6 months after that because they went, well, what do we do with a dancer? Can he talk? They don't believe we could talk, you know. And it was a very difficult period for me, that.
What all-rounders were starting to struggle with was television's need to label them. Roy Castle was already known as the British Sammy Davis Jr. He was undoubtedly a star, but he struggled to find the right vehicle for his talents. I'll build a world
of my own. No one knows better. He could sing, dance, you know, was perfect at ease in front of any audience, large or small. Just watch
this. It's Coy Russell!
No,
how are you?
Castle.
If you were going out into the theatre or on a television show and you had Roy Castle on the bill, you know, he was going to deliver for you.
Eric, Roy Castle has got what you lack.
What's that?
Versatility.
Versatility? What's versatility? Give us a quick flash. Go on, I dare you.
He's multi-talented and he's a great musician.
Well, I'm a great musician. I'm never without me drumsticks. Look, I carry them everywhere. That's why I limp. Oh.
His problem was that he was jack of all trades, but not quite master of any of them.
Well, that was all right, but I mean, I can play the trumpet.
Can you?
Certainly.
It was such a shame. He wasn't appreciated, but he somehow couldn't give that sex appeal. I can only say sex appeal through the camera.
Bob Monkhouse, on the other hand, oozed star quality and sex appeal. He adopted the American style of performing from the beginning of his career.
I do thank you for having me. For those who haven't had me yet, please be patient.
Bob's style was American. It was the very smart stand-up. It wasn't the fool. It wasn't the failure. You know, it wasn't the vulnerable one.
Monkhouse was such hot property that he and writing partner Dennis Goodwin scoured the world for material.
They listened to radio from all around the world, and they put down every joke and every comedy remark, and had a wonderful filing system. Undertaker's gags, oh, we'll have that one. Might change it just to suit the spot.
With his good looks, TV was now pursuing Bob Monkhouse in a big way.
They have a good spell. Hello, very nice to see you. Very glad you're able to look in. Ladies and gentlemen, I've had some letters since the last show we did. One or two people have written saying that I haven't a romantic personality, and this hurt me. It really did. In fact, one of my biggest problems is, am I too sexy to get loves?
Bob was the front man. He was well on the way to success and sort of minor stardom.
But Dennis Goodwin didn't want to be the backroom boy, and their relationship fell apart.
Dennis's ambition was to top the bill at the London Palladium. And I'd never met anybody less suited to that ambition in my life.
And I think being, I hope not cruel, Bob was more photogenic than Dennis and would naturally have a greater appeal on television than Dennis, I think.
Realising he had a shot at stardom, Monkhouse grabbed every opportunity he could. He even got cast as the leading man in the first Carry On film.
Three, one, two, private stage C, sir. Now say it backwards. Come on.
Three, Bob one, went from success to success, principally because he worked so hard. He hassled every director on sound, radio and television and theatre to get a job, and he made quite sure that he did.
Watch this man, Sergeant. Rigid mental processes achieve flexibility. Flexibility plus discipline equals common initiative.
It does, sir? It does, sir.
It does, yes.
The only other all-round entertainer to take on the American style was Dickie Henderson.
Let's rehearse.
Like Monkhouse, his act was that of a slick, laid-back performer.
Dickie was kind of... he had a kind of mid-Atlantic accent. You know, he was Mr. Smooth, Mr. Entertainer.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Dickie Henderson Show.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to my show. I can say my show with a certain degree of confidence because I have proof. You see, I have a stool.
He was much influenced by that kind of transatlantic... smooth, suave, sophistication. He was more sophisticated. Although he was a knockabout comedian at heart, he had an air of sophistication that the others didn't have.
And it's nice. It makes you feel secure, you know. I first got mine 5 years ago and I gave up sucking my thumb. And they're nice. You can get your feet caught in them, or you can cross your legs and you can fall off. But anyway, right now I'm going to introduce my first guest, who has his own show? Very good pal of mine, Roy Cutt.
By the early 1960s, even the American style was old hat. Now, entertainment was full of young, working-class Liverpudlians.
There were these four lovable rascals from Liverpool. Thank God they came in, because we all came in on their coattails.
In 1965, at the height of Beatlemania, comedian Jimmy Tarbuck became the host of the new London Palladium show.
I can see it's crowded out here. You should see it backstage.
I had the haircut. I wore the high button suits. I was skinny in those days, and I looked, to all intents and purposes, like a Beatle.
He was part of the swinging 60s. He just looked fabulous.
Hey!
He was a riot.
John Lennon used to take the piss out of me.
He said, that's
Jim. Oh, here he is. The fifth one. They'd all roar laughing. But he used to do terrible tricks to you. And he put some speed in my drink, which is a very naughty thing to do. So I've knocked it back and all that. Next minute, ding! I'm like a kangaroo, bouncing everywhere. I never slept for 3 days. And I saw him, and about a week later, he went, how did you sleep with that? I said, you never, ever, you do that to me again. He thought that was hilarious. And it was all just wonderful fun.
Walking down the street, pretty woman.
He started off at the London Palladium as a young, cocky, Liverpudlian lad who came on and absolutely cleaned up.
Got all my gear on tonight. Do you like it?
Yeah.
Cheeky, I'll tell you. I've only got it on because I'm a dedicated follower of fashion. They seek him here. They seek him there. His clothes are loud, but never square.
make or break him, but he's got to buy the best, cos he's a dedicated follower.
I was inexperienced for the job, but dear God, it was exciting and wonderful, and I was working with the biggest stars in the world,
Step inside, love. Let me find you a place where the girls.
The next Scouse star to hit big was 25-year-old pop singer Cilla Black. She was to become one of the biggest all-round entertainers for the next 40 years.
She worked like mad. She rehearsed from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m, 5 days a week.
You did your sketches, you did intercamera, you did dance routines. I'm not a trained dancer, so I feel steps. I don't count. You know, 6, 7, 8, the. No, can't do that. Just tell me which part of the song you want me to jiggle me bits and I'll do it.
Oh, well, the jukebox are playing like a one-man band. It's the only kind of music that we all understand. We're gonna be all...
But it wasn't the songs or dances that were to make her name. It was her relationship with the public.
What are your favourite programmes on
the
television?
I like the James Bond mystery things, you know, one of these things.
I think Cilla's stood out in that world by really dint of her extraordinary natural ability to understand the public. She's got an extremely good antenna.
Like Kung Fu, that Chinaman.
Do you?
Yes, it's a very nice programme.
You don't have to bottle what she's on. She's the girl next door that everybody likes.
Whisper. Don't you know who I am? You want me to whisper? It's in the black. It was magic. It was that little bit of TV magic. How come you didn't recognise me?
Well, you're different on the stage, aren't you?
Well, how am I different?
You're more, aren't you?
I guess, you know, the public chose me to be a TV star. I didn't choose it. The TV public chose me. And thank God they did.
I think Cilla Black is unique in as much as she is a female entertainer in a world of male entertainers. And it is that she is so secure. She believes in herself. And she has charisma. She has charisma. She believes that out there everybody's very lucky to be watching her. Don't ever tell her that, though.
But by the 1970s, the fashion changed again. Now, it was all about game shows.
And cash jackpots today, let's meet. Linda and Brian Edmondson from Hartlepool in the Tyne Tees television area. Rose and Martin Hodgkin from West Pinchbeck, Spalding in the central area. And Jean and Albert Durkin from Kendal in the border region.
The game show formats emerged because they're cheap to do. People will come on for nothing, for small rewards. You only have to pay the host. And there's guaranteed drama.
The money ITV were making was irresistible, and they forged ahead with more game show formats.
Welcome once again, ladies and gentlemen, to another exciting edition of 3-2-1.
3-2-1. I can't do it now. But it was Ted's own idea. And it became, a huge national catchphrase.
A well-devised game show is so dramatic that even you and I will watch it. We just pretend we don't.
With few other outlets to showcase their talents, the all-rounders queued up for their chance to do a game show.
There was no other television outlet. There were no variety shows. Variety had gone.
Actually, sometimes they take these jobs as a boost to a sagging career. So rather than be detrimental, often it lifts the career just a bit. A bit more exposure, a bit more fun, you know.
When you think of the excitement today, if you get a show that gets 5 or 6 million, these days people used to get 20 million viewers. That was what everybody talked about the following day. Did you see the golden shot?
Birmingham, it's the golden shot. And here's the man who keeps it bang on target. Here's Bobby.
Let's start playing the golden shot and find out who's first to ring in for a go at our target.
Bob Monkhouse was the master of the of the British Game Show. I don't think there's anybody since or before who did it as well as he did.
In a 20-second duel of the champions, this is the target that'll decide who goes through to the Golden Sun worth £600.
I don't think he ever thought of it being a progression from comedy to presenting game shows. I think he thought of it as rather as an extension. I think he just thought it was another string to his bow.
You've got to be able to be funny while directing traffic if you're going to have people walking around all over the place, like we had on Golden Shot. And not everybody's cup of tea, that. I just relished it.
He was a sort of template for other game show hosts. I mean, you'd sort of look and think, even though it wasn't the way you would do it, but you'd look and think, what would Bob do, or what did Bob do in this sort of situation?
A brace of vaults, please.
With Bob Monkhouse as host, the Golden Shot surged from 2 million to 16 million viewers.
Sad little scene. 20 seconds that begin now.
Being a presenter of those, that type of show is a very difficult job. If there are unexpected things happen, and they always do, you've got to be able to ad-lib your way out of it.
And Mrs. Breaker's missed it. It's up there.
She just touched the trigger and it went off. I'm afraid she didn't realise what a hair trigger that is.
It's the all-round entertainers who have had that training experience from all those years in clubs and pubs and variety theatre and into television who are better equipped to deal with it.
This winning combination of a strong format and a great host set the benchmark for every game show that followed.
Better than being slapped in the belly with a wet card. You're well off. You're about half an inch.
By the early 1970s, ITV were winning the ratings war, and the BBC had to find a way to fight back. They needed their own game show.
Off I go to Utrecht, and there was a show they were doing called One Out of Eight.
Maar dat lied, dat hadden we toen aangepast en de beginregels waren, we hebben met z'n allen...
As I sat there through the 2 hours, not understanding a word, my mind wandered, and I thought, there is an idea here, and the person who could do it would be Bruce Forsyth. In the and his career at that time was kind of at a level, you know, he was working and popular, but he hadn't actually got a vehicle.
My agent and myself went to see Bill Cotton with a view to doing a talk show.
I wanted him to do this because I really believed he was the best person in the world to do this type of show.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Good evening, ladies, gentlemen, and children. Welcome to The Generation Game. Nice to see you,
Nice!
There we are.
From the word go, it was a success. You know, the thing worked.
It was a show where you brought the punters on. It was the end of the pier. Come on, I'm looking for two volunteers. A fantastic show.
Another show. All right, we've got another one here.
I used to watch the rehearsals of The Generation Game with the floor manager doing my bit. And by me looking at it, I could see, oh yeah, it'd be better if I said that. And if I move them from there to there, I could see things.
I will say to you, you know, an organ of the body, you have to write in or make a diagram of the size that you think it is.
What Bruce was given was a slave camera, which meant wherever he was on the set, there was a close-up of him there. So if a member of the audience said something, it was really funny, and Bruce was being upstaged because that member of the public was much funnier than him, he would just do a Jack Benny, which was just...
You were a schoolmaster in Chesterfield, teaching history and English.
Are you interested in history?
Oh, love history.
Old things.
Oh, yeah.
Some of your jokes are a bit like that, aren't they?
Plain fact of the matter was that he was made for the Generation Game, and the Generation Game was made for him.
The climax of the show was the conveyor belt full of goodies.
It was a very short conveyor belt, probably only about 6 foot long, and there was rows of men putting trays on and Roseman taking trays on. It was actually all very tidy and neat, but behind the scenes it was gentle chaos.
An infrared grill, a cuddly gorilla, a gorilla, an insulated jug.
But despite the success of the show, the BBC weren't comfortable with giving away prizes.
We had a wide range of discussions at which the notion of perhaps giving the contestants prizes of stamps for licence fees and all sorts of ways of getting around the notion of consumer durables. But nothing was as good as the cuddly toy and the microwave.
We got the drill. The cassette player. The cassette player, the golf indoor thing. Yes. And we got the drill. Yeah. The what? Oh, the golf. We got the golf. Good. Didn't she do well? Yes.
While Bruce Forsyth's career soared, that other great entertainer, Roy Castle, was struggling to land his own Saturday night show and was reduced to bit parts and guest spots to earn a living.
Learn to play the spoons and lose a few fingers.
Roy ended up on children's TV because he had outrun his success.
I taught Roy into doing a programme in children's time, in the early evening, you know, early afternoon and evening. And I said to him, you'll find that you'll build an audience there which will be very loyal to you for the rest of your life, you know.
Roy Castle stayed with Record Breakers for the next 20 years. It wasn't the prime-time vehicle he wanted, but at least he could show his versatility.
He sang, I think, the majority or all of the different theme tunes. He, of course, attempted world records himself, tap dancing, playing instruments, been in the biggest band.
It was an amazing thing because suddenly he was of interest to a lot of children and teenagers who hadn't known about him as an entertainer.
What he really loved to do was actually stand on stage and entertain people, like playing his instruments and singing songs and acting.
And all that jazz.
We're the only twirl in the world. Lovely. Oh, yeah. But what colour is
After
that?
7 years of BBC dominance, ITV finally fought back.
This is 11.45.
11.45? Yeah. Why 11.45?
We'll be off before midnight. Come on, for goodness sake. Tis the last show.
ITV decided to steal Bruce Forsyth away from the BBC and offered him a massive £15,000 a week to jump ship.
Always leave a show when it's at the top. Never leave a show when it is starting to fail, because when you do that, you go down with the sinking ship.
I worked and worked on him to try and get him to leave. And eventually we created Bruce's Big Night at London Weekend Television, which was a showcase for all of his talents.
It's Bruce Forsyth's Big Night. Oh, happy day.
They promoted it as though the second Messiah was going to arrive. I mean, it was quite ridiculous.
You know that he really was. Wash my sins away.
It was an hour and a half live every week with so many things in, so it was a very hard show to do.
In amongst Forsyth performing, there would be special guests, contestants playing games, fancy dress parades, and even a big money game show.
Ladies and gentlemen, Sammy Davis Jr.
But most important to Bruce Forsyth were his celebrity guests.
Thank you. I would like to do now a thing that I've been doing every time I come to England. This is one of those numbers.
Didn't anybody tell you this was my show?
If they had, would I have been here?
The Big Night was fun mainly because it did involve me working with other performers.
Well, then switch chairs with me over here. Switch chairs, because I've got a few impressions. Then I want you to switch chairs.
Didn't he do well?
Good game. That you do. Nice to see you.
You wouldn't see those people every week. They'd be special for that one show.
I'll be with you in a minute. I need all the props, you see. I'd just like to say, Bruce, that
you're not only a great all-round performer, you're a great all-round human being.
That wasn't light entertainment. That was heavy.
It's the big night in on ITV. I can't see you, but you can see me on the network. Every Saturday night. Get the whole of the network together tonight.
But the big night was a big flop.
Thank you.
And Bruce was public enemy number one for having deserted the Generation Game and so on. And there was just no way we could bring the show back. It was just too... you know, we had to cut our losses, really.
Bruce made a perfectly understandable error of judgment in thinking that he had the Generation Game was restricting him. Well, of course it was. A format does.
If the format isn't good, then you do fall by the wayside and you'll take the blame.
When your head starts to swirl, it's the thing you've got... it's the realisation you've got to hold on to. The format is king. Without the format, you're dead. It isn't just you. You can't just go on in the sense of go on the air, because if you just go on the air, then you're doomed.
By the mid-70s, the popularity of working men's clubs began to influence the world of light entertainment. A young comedian from Sheffield, Marty Kane, was the first to cross over, but it wasn't easy.
She was so blue. She was mauve. I've never heard any female so rude in my life.
I've escaped out of a dressing room window many nights, you know.
Literally?
In the north, yes, and when you sing, you have to sing like this so that the bottles don't get you.
She came off, I gave her so long to get changed, went into the dressing room, she said, are you going to take me on? And I said, Marty, I can't take you on. You're so rude, you're so blue, I just can't stand it. How you get away with it in these clubs is okay, but you'll never get away with it outside of these clubs, in corporates and things. She said, I'll do anything you tell me, just straighten the act out, but take me on. And that's how we started.
Please welcome Miss Marty Kane.
Within weeks, Marty was on ITV's talent show, New Faces.
Memories light the corners of my mind. Misty watercolored memories of the way...
She used to call it the destruction of elegance. She used to look elegant and beautiful and then trip or fall. And that was her comedy, I think.
What I'd really like is that plastic surgery, you know, and have my nose off. Look at that for a nose. When they were giving out noses, I thought they said roses and asked for a big red one. Look at that.
People weren't necessarily looking for, you know, a glamorous comedian. I mean, America had Lucille Ball, but, you know, duh, it hadn't seemed to connect over here that maybe there'd be somebody lurking in the wings.
Nobody can fight.
Me!
Another veteran of the Northern club scene was also hitting the heights on ITV.
This is the part of the programme which is entitled Get It Off Your Chest.
55-year-old Larry Grayson had been working the circuit for over 30 years before landing his own show.
He never came out, so he was never officially gay, but he was the master of the innuendo.
He loves the water. You know, it's good for his war wound. And, he went out there, and I was terrified because he got into trouble with an octopus. I thought, Everard's gone, and I shouted out, cut off its tentacles! Well, the lifeguard was deaf, and you know...
It is true that he put... jolly nearly put the word gay into common usage. You know, I mean, people didn't... I mean, what a gay day, you know, and all those kind of things he had, those catchphrases, you know.
It's a change of scenery. No, I mean, I...
Comic Larry Grayson received unexpected attention from the BBC, who were looking for a new host for the Generation Game.
The chorus worked very well. I could have done it all before.
I had to go and find out who was going to replace Bruce. And, you know, a lot of people had ideas. And I went against all the grain. People were looking for a Bruce Zimmer, a lookalike. There was a time, I think, one of the names, Barrymore was considered, but he was too young. He hadn't yet become his where he had got to. Roy Castle was considered. And I just said, no, I don't want to have a competitor to Bruce. I don't want people to think this is, oh, Bruce is better. So I want to go in a completely different direction.
Larry Grayson became the first mainstream camp entertainer on Saturday night.
Larry Grayson is here to play school.
Shut that door.
What we realised with Larry is he couldn't do anything. He was handless.
Don't worry, I'm not going to spit. And it's anything.
So if we found a contestant that had done a Potter's Wheel or a spaghetti, we'd say, Larry, oh, I'll have a try. Of course it was chaos.
Larry was a bit all over the place and it was kind of a bit haphazard, but there was a vulnerability about it, combined with his natural timing and these funny looks and these funny expressions that people just, it sort of captivated the people.
You know, she hasn't been well all day.
He was very good at ad-libbing and timing was natural.
Albert and Wynne. Could be the start of a film. Albert and Wynne, twice nightly.
He should be so lucky. What a good...
Wynne, you are cheeky.
He knew when to make that famous look. Bruce was doing an entirely different technique. He was looking at it for the comedy line, going, oh, get them, look how bad they are. Whereas Larry was doing the opposite by saying, oh, can you imagine?
Evan Grayson, join us, please. What? Put your hand on your side, please. Oh.
His entertainment skill, that inside the gene, he knew when it was funny.
Power! Huh. Huh.
Grayson's chaotic style made The Generation Game an even bigger hit than before, with viewing figures topping 18 million. Yet again, ITV had to come up with a spoiler to beat the BBC's dominance of Saturday night. But this time, they didn't target the presenter, they went for the producer.
The Generation Game dominated the ratings. It was Saturday nights. The BBC owned Saturday nights. Boyd was poached to sink The Generation Game.
In 1981, LWT came up with a format so daring, it would change light entertainment forever. The All-Rounders were about to lose out to a new type of performer.
Game for Alarm, the show where the people are the stars.
This was the start of the famous reality. It was a real people show. People were the stars, that's what the title said. We used American-type opening credits, teasing the show, which had never been done before. We made them run down the stairs. People said, this is silly. And these were four young presenters they didn't know, and they were doing silly things. There were silly people. They were painting the Fourth Bridge. They were going to nudist camp. Sun newspaper, disgusting ITV, people go to nudist camps. It was a hysterical story, never been done before. So we broke all the boundaries.
How do you rate your chances this year?
Yeah. Well, keep your fingers crossed.
If you look back at Sunday night at London Palladium, you know, the best bid on that weren't the big names, that was the draw, that was the bums on seats. The most entertaining part of Sunday Night London Palladium was Beat the Clock. Because you used ordinary people, getting them doing crazy things in the hope of winning nothing.
I'd like to continue on that theme because I'm looking for four brave ladies who are game for a laugh.
It was tough to find a host, and it was the show's researcher, Jeremy Beadle, who begged for the job of practical joker.
The exec producer said to Alan Boyd, you will never make a star of anybody with a beard. And there he had two people on his show with beards, both of whom went on to achieve national notoriety, in my case.
Right, Linda, you're looking forward to this, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yes, great, good, OK. Now, all we want you to do is just pick a pocket and just tell us what you think's in there. Anyone? What do you think it is?
A rat, or
something? A rat!
The skills of a presenter change because, historically, the people that hosted the shows were all-round entertainers. They could burst in a song, they could tap dance, they could do back somersaults and do whatever you want, do a bit of patter.
It's up to you.
The genre could now be presented by non-entertainment variety acts, and therefore you could be a weatherman, or you could be a presenter, or you could be a journalist, or you could be a news presenter. It just opened it up. You didn't have to have been a redcoat or been on the Palladium stage for 20 years.
For a traditional all-rounder like Bruce Forsyth, the lack of variety shows was now becoming a problem, and he was soon forced back to the game shows.
In show business, you get lots of highs, which are wonderful, and sometimes you get lots of lows. Sometimes you get more lows than highs. That's the kind of business it is.
Lower than an ace, you say, a queen! Yeah. And this is for the match! Yes! Yeah.
Bruce Forsyth used to do Play Your Cards Right, a ton of them. It was a way to print money in those days.
Well then, well done! Well done! And you've won a Brucey bonus, thank
you. I said,
darling.
What is taking you so long to edit Play Your Cards Right? The Dolly Dealers are there, Bruce is there, the contestants are there, the cards come up. Why are you taking a week to edit one show? They used to edit out all of your Bruce will kill me for that. Good evening. Welcome to Play Your Cards Right. And they would edit out the and it would just go, good evening and welcome to Play Your Cards Right.
It's not too late, it could still be a big night if you play your cards right. Good night. Thank you.
And then there was Michael Barrymore. Barrymore's anarchic and unscripted performances captivated the viewers.
Is this the microphone? Yeah. Oh, God! Oh, oh,
oh. He has that ability to kind of be dangerous with the public, and he had it then, and yet to somehow pull them in and make them feel relaxed.
Barrymore's anarchic and unscripted performances captivated the viewers.
Thought I might have a kip.
I actually genuinely do like people, always have done. I find them fascinating, whoever they are, even those that consider the meanest. I think there's something in there, if you can only get to it.
Oh, well, that's all right. Come over here. What's your name?
Daisy.
Oh, Daisy, are you? There we are. Just get you up here, that's it. I'll get you up, Daisy.
Oh, yeah. Don't talk, mate.
Do what?
You know, providing you're not breaking the boundaries and the person's happy. And if you look at a lot of the stuff where I've got the body contact with people, it's just mucking about in the front row.
There we are. There we go. That's... All right.
Oh, yeah, lovely, isn't
it? Just come down on the arm there, girl, you'll be all right.
I
think,
yeah.
You want to run it nice and hard, so it's, I can't go to sleep with you laughing, I've got...
As himself, he's a very shy, rather withdrawn man. It's only when he gets on stage or he gets infused and excited in the rehearsal room about a project that you see this thing come from within. This kind of aura takes over, and the talent that he's got suddenly comes out.
What do you mean, wait for me? What?
Oh, my secretary. She's got to wait for me.
She's got to wait for you?
Oh, yeah.
Well, and where do you think we're... Well, they're not going to go anywhere.
You'd be surprised. They might be going home.
They might be going... Well, oh, sorry, we're keeping you up, love.
The other big star of the 80s began the decade as an almost forgotten figure. But after appearing on Wogan to plug her new album, Cilla was inundated with television offers.
I want you to stay.
Your voice has lost none of its sweetness, has it?
Oh, isn't that nice? What you're saying is I'm getting old. No, I mean, it's true, though. I'm 40 this year, Terry.
I'm not looking forward to my own 40th.
Well, I was going to ask you, can you remember when you were 40?
And it was ITV who persuaded her to come back.
Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Cilla Black.
Surprise, Surprise was really a brand new concept. It really was, all based around everything that I'd done in my career.
Because Surprise, Surprise, you are going to Wembley!
Some television shows eat themselves because you can never do the same game again. People know you're going to do a twin switch or whatever. Other shows, like Surprise, Surprise, feed themselves. In other words, you get 80,000 people wanting to find people.
Everybody remembers, you know, the last tug at the heartstring story.
Because Surprise, Surprise, here are your brothers and sisters. Why don't you come and join us in 50 years?
I tried not to make it mawkish, but still they remember it, don't they?
50 years!
Realising that she was a ratings hit, ITV scoured the world to find another winning format for her.
Thank you, thank you. Hello and welcome to Blind Date.
It wasn't about a couple getting it together. It was actually the process of romance, the dating process, trying it out. So that's why Cilla was thrilled if there was any suggestion with a relationship or a marriage even. You know, she could go out and buy a new hat and go to the wedding, we'd get another special out of it.
So let's say hi to the boys.
Unfortunately, in the later years, and I think this is why Cilla got disillusioned with it, is that it got too much about couples going off and whether they had sex or not.
Was there a passionate kiss?
Yeah, we snogged.
You did, Nick. We did. You didn't snog.
I think I'm old enough to know what a snog is.
Right. So am I, Nick. And if I snogged you, you'd know all about it.
Well.
Look, Cilla, I came on Blind Date for a romantic. Meet someone really romantic and nice, but instead, I got a geezer bird.
Yeah. And I can. I better say, ladies and gentlemen, wish them well, Ty and Caroline.
But after 18 years of matchmaking, Cilla had had enough.
We did a live Blind Date to try and... We were trying to revive the brand at the time, give it a bit of promotional trickery.
This is Blind Date Live.
And she took that opportunity to say thank you and good night.
And I didn't know... till 2 minutes before the live Blind Date. I thought, what a great opportunity.
Hello and welcome to this very special live show. And you know what, ladies and gentlemen, it is a very special live show because this is going to be my very, very last series of Blind Date.
That was, to me, the consummate statement of the fact that here was a woman who knew exactly what she was doing.
It was the right time. And I hope it was done in good taste.
It's Family Fortunes.
By the early 80s, game shows were the only work available to the all-round entertainers.
All here to play Family Fortunes.
Bob Monkhouse had now established himself as the master of the quiz show.
The fact that the majority of the audience just regards me as a game show host rankled at one time because I thought, oh, dear, what... Because game show hosts were respected when we first started doing game shows. There was even a BAFTA award for the best game shows. But we got equated with double glazing salesmen and timeshare salesmen as being a bit glitzy and self-serving.
Oh, thank you. Your applause has been recorded and will be sent on to less fortunate stars.
Many people, in fact, found him smarmy. You know, hello, I'm Bob Monkhouse, and all that, you know.
I think he put up with it, but I think underneath, he seethed. I really do. I think sometimes he just wanted to turn around and punch people.
It was my job to say, what is the capital of Peru? Lima? Is correct. Now, you could take a holiday in Mallorca during the pause, but the pause was important to the show. And even if it made me seem irritating, so that's part of the programme too.
I think game shows gave him the lifestyle that he enjoyed very much. They make five in a day sometimes, you know? Which, when you're on a nice salary, for one, multiplied by five, gives you a lot of freedom for the rest of the week.
Probably if he were around today, he'd be doing a Sudoku show. I hate Sudoku.
Apart from Cilla, the only other woman on Saturday night was Marty Kane.
Oh, where's Velvet? Do you know, I did my shopping in this today. I got mugged by two stray flamingos. Oh, dear, mind you, you've got to be fit, you know, for show business. I'm a big believer in that yoga myself, especially strawberry flavoured.
She was just a pleasure and a joy to work with, and very, very funny. You know, you sort of, like, watch when they're doing their own thing, like, oh, I could say that better. I could do that better. I could say, she's very funny. That's a great line. She was very, and then when I heard she wrote it, I suddenly had great respect for her.
In 1986, she was given the ultimate accolade, host of New Faces, the show that had launched her to stardom 10 years before.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, and welcome to New Faces 86.
We used to have this kind of sparring match on the show. You know, she'd say something and I'd insult her or insult her frock or her hair or, you know, and then she'd come back at me. And people watching thought, oh, God, they don't get on at all.
You know, the Glamorous Grannies novelty contest, fine, because the jokes are about as old as that. I'm sorry, but they are.
Yes, well, that's Nina's opinion. How about you, Chris? What did you think?
I've no idea. She frightened me to death.
Marty Kane was a great inspiration and just a lot of help on the show. She stood up for a lot of the acts, well, for all of the acts, even the ones that were cack, like me.
Our next New Faces act defies description. He's a sort of... No, but then again, he's more of a... Make your own mind up. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Joe Pasquale.
I haven't been in show business long. I used to be a long-distance lorry driver on the Isle of Wight.
The only star that was discovered in my whole 3 years as a panellist was Joe Pasquale.
Everybody thought that I was a successful working club act that had been going donkey's years, and I wasn't. You know, I just fluked it on New Faces.
And he only came to prominence 20 years after New Faces finished.
However much I died on my arse out in the clubs, however much people shouted, get off Pufta, or Squeaky, clear off, whatever they shouted at me when I was on stage, I knew it was better than having half a dead cow on me back at Smithfield's meat market.
Meanwhile, the game show's dominance was complete with ITV's latest acquisition.
Here's television's new exciting family game show, The Voice is Right!
But such a monstrous show needed the right host.
I said, look, you've got to understand that you've got to get someone who can actually handle... This is a complicated show to run through, and you've got to get someone who's a professional.
And the producer's choice was...
Your host, Leslie Crowther!
Wendy Partridge!
Leslie's career a bit. It had been sort of even. He had done Crackerjack and all those things, and he'd done situation comedy, you know, with My Good Woman, I think, and he had done other things. And it was just taking a little bit of, you know, just a little bubbling along. And The Price is Right absolutely shot him straight back to the top.
Come on now! You are our first four contestants on The Price is Right!
The public took to it immediately. It knocked Coronation Street off the top of the ratings. And I mean the very top.
He loved people. He did like people very much. And he really meant it when he wanted them to win a washing machine. As he said, it's all very well people being snooty and saying, oh, just for a washing machine. But some people don't have a new washing machine.
Denise, what is the real price of that fabulous thing there? Yes! Well, Norma, you've won that. OK, now, this is what you really wanted to win, isn't it?
Oh, it's
the tumble dryer. What is the real price of the tumble dryer? My lovely Julia, tell me. Yes! Oh, you've got it. Well, wonderful.
A massive success, the show gave Leslie Crowther the biggest hit of his career, and audiences couldn't get enough.
One you wanted, and you won another one as well.
By the mid-90s, even Michael Barrymore had jumped on the game show bandwagon.
Basically, if you look at Strike It Lucky, that's a format, it's a pile of crap. The actual format lasted about 5 minutes. The other rest of the show was just bucking around and sodding about. So it was a good vehicle for me to do what I do.
What?
Bob Monkhouse used to say that Michael Barrymore was a guy that would go to the end of the gangplank to find out there wasn't a boat there before stepping off. And I can see that, you know, he would just mine these areas of people.
Well, I wouldn't do your washing for the week.
Do my washing?
Yeah.
You like to do my washing?
Oh, yeah.
Why?
Well, your pants would be blowing by my nicks and the
lines. Here we go, we're off again.
He was unique at that time. There was nobody like him. He was so daring, so audacious, so brilliant. I mean, the incredible thing was people would say to me, as the producer, what's happening tonight? And really, I had only the haziest idea.
Somebody apparently rang down when I was doing Strike. I said, would you tell him to keep still, you know, when he's mentioning the prizes? And Morris said, well, you tell him. I ain't going to tell him to stand still. That's what he's all about.
What do you do for a living?
He's been in the Navy. Yeah. Oh. Yeah. 2 weeks.
Hey? 2 weeks. For 2 weeks? What happened there, John?
You got pals.
You got pals? Nice of them to tell us this, wasn't it?
I can't wait till we get home.
Well, I won't go on about it, John. We don't want to embarrass you about things like this. These things happen, and there's no need to embarrass people about these things.
That's right.
So how long did you happen for then, John?
Any game show or any quiz show, what are they? They're all an excuse, whatever the format is, to ask general knowledge questions. That's all they are. It's no more than that. If you look at anything, it's a system of asking questions. It's how you get to that.
Middle. In the middle for the middle. Jackpot, come on, all! This is for the jackpot, OK? This is for £10,000.
Oh, good.
The capital of Australia is Canberra. Is that true or false? And I'm, like, giving it to them, and they still go... And you see the audience go, true, 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 true. And I'm going, true...
£10,000!
He was so popular that when he went on the road with a new show, over 50,000 people turned up to meet him.
My kind of people was my idea originally. I said, which if you look at my kind of people, it's the early days of version of Pop Idol, because we were the first ones to show all the bad ones and the good ones as well.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are grey. You'll never know, Michael, how much I love you.
You've got to take this somewhere. You need some medication.
be back. See you after the break. All right.
By 1995, Michael Barrymore had won every major award in television.
Oh, and the winner is Michael Barrymore.
Even if he does throw the odd one out from time to time, he's generously applauded other people tonight, and now he received his own award.
Strange place to keep a hostess.
It was an extraordinary ability. Unfortunately, alongside it, he had his demons. And he was, as many performers are, deeply lacking in self-confidence. He knows he's special. He knows he's brilliant. And yet, maybe they'll all find him out. Maybe it'll all go wrong. Maybe it'll stop tomorrow. Because really, what is it?
Give me what I ask for. You know the BBC will love it and they'll pay more.
So the one half of his brain, he knows that he is probably as good as it gets. And the other half of the brain is, he doesn't know what it is. And if he thinks too hard about it, it'll go away. And maybe he'll wake up tomorrow morning, it won't be there. And of course, that's actually what happened.
But that's the danger you've got to watch with the comedians. They spend all their lives making everybody else happy, and they can be wretched inside, you know?
Smile, though your heart is aching. Sky, you'll get by.
But despite massive popularity, Barrymore was pursued relentlessly by the tabloid press.
Smile and maybe tomorrow.
Whoever you are, however tough you think you are, or however tough you happen to be, no one is immune to picking up newspapers which are being read by millions and seeing hideous things written about yourself day after day after day.
Eventually, it all spiralled out of control.
Flamboyant Michael Barrymore, one of Britain's best-known TV quizmasters, now finds himself answering the questions posed by Essex detectives.
I think the saddest thing about Michael Barrymore is that he surrounded himself with sycophants, and they did as much damage to him as he did to himself.
The job of a broadcaster is to nurture your talent until you don't need them anymore.
Rightly or wrongly, the fact of the matter is, if you're a popular entertainer, one of the kind of requirements of that job is that you're popular. And he clearly at that time was very unpopular.
Barrymore's fall from grace was spectacular.
Tomorrow you'll see the sun come shining through if you just smile.
Hot on the heels of Barrymore was Brian Connolly, another entertainer from the holiday camp circuit.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, my name's Brian Connolly, and I do alternative comedy. I don't make people laugh.
Brian Connolly is an extremely funny, old-fashioned entertainer. In the old definition of an entertainer, great gag merchant. He's a traditionally fully equipped entertainer.
He and Michael Barrymore probably have one thing in common, and that is neither of them have really got an act. If the audience is with them from when they walk out, it happens.
And now we come to... Excuse me, thank you. Now we come to Derek here. Derek was given the heart of a dog. So if he starts licking himself in unexpected places... Please, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming in, Derek.
I love doing what I do. I love going out. I love entertaining. I feel very comfortable on stage, and I always feel, this is where I belong.
By 1992, Brian Connolly had his own signature show.
With his old mate, buddy pal, Larry the Loafer! Larry, you fancy a cracker? Thanks for that! It's a puppy!
Nick Frisby and Larry the Loafer was Philip Schofield in the broom cupboard, and
And, it, you know, Gordon the Gopher, you know, Larry Loaf was just a play on those words, you know. And Dangerous Brian was just... It's me, really.
Dangerous Brian here, ready to help anyone, anywhere, wherever in the world, any time of day or night.
I was numero uno. You know, everyone has a moment. Ricky Gervais has had his moment, Peter Kay's had his moment. But Dangerous Brian and everything else, you know, that was it.
A classic all-rounder, Connolly diversified to keep on working, and he went on to star on Broadway playing Al Jolson.
You know, in my sort of mid-30s, when I thought, I'm going to be an actor now, a thespian. I do not require a microphone. I shall go out there now and show them my other things. It's all about having, you know, different fingers in different pies, and that is what keeps you there as well, I believe, you know. If you've got all your eggs in one basket, you know, if that goes down, goodbye.
One of the last ex-redcoats who jumped onto our screens was Shane Ritchie.
Shane Ritchie was always an energetic comedian. He'd be running around the stage, perspiring before he even got on the stage, and then sweating all over the audience. The front two rows, it was like going to one of these sea parks, you know, where the dolphin splashes down and you get wet.
Ritchie was a huge success as a Saturday night performer.
Beat Records proudly presents Larry Grayson Sings the Beach Boys. Hits like Round, round, get around. Get around, I get around, round. Ooh, I get around. I pick it up. Get round, well, hey ho, and away we go.
But like Brian Connolly, his ambitions lay beyond light entertainment.
Comics normally make good actors, and they like the opportunity so to do. And the scripts for EastEnders were fantastic. And he just relished the chance to go out there and prove that he could do it.
Love, just stop feeling sorry for yourself and do something about it.
Oh, I'm cursed.
Got two women on the go, some curse.
I love them both. Now, you can think whatever you want, Billy, but that's the truth, OK? And of all the women I met in my life, they come first and second. Yeah, I just couldn't decide which was which.
But say you're messing both about.
I wasn't messing them about. I knew whoever I chose, I'd end up spending the rest of my life with. It was that serious.
Today, the biggest names in entertainment are the first generation of all-rounders who have learned to entertain without working the variety circuit.
They never had an act as such. They never went around doing the theatres or the clubs or anything like that. They started off as child actors in Biker Grove.
You can't see.
They've come right through the ranks together. Both as friends, as colleagues, as mates. They're married.
They can bounce off each other. It's not just scripted. It gives you the same feeling as you got when you were watching Morecambe and Wise. Two guys that could sit in bed together.
It brings the tears to your eyes, doesn't it?
That's the expression I was looking for, yeah.
And everyone wanted a friend like that, that, you know, you could take the piss out of, or you could just enjoy being with.
Jack, my friend.
Yes.
How do you feel?
I feel tired, emotional, a little bit itchy under me.
People think they're unassailable. They're not. They will have their time and things will change. But at the moment, they quite rightly have their title. You know, Kings of Saturday Night, without a doubt.
Ironically, for all its success, their biggest hit, Saturday Night Takeaway, is essentially a traditional variety show not a million miles from Sunday night at the London Palladium. So powerful are Ant and Dec that they've even managed to cash in on the reality boom that killed off so many entertainment shows.
Those are our 10 new celebrities. Yeah. Picked your favourite yet? Worked out who's going to get on your nerves? Decided which one you fancy?
I have. Yes. There's a couple of tasty blondes in there. Can't quite choose between them yet.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Gilly or Carol? Which one is hotter, do you think?
In the 21st century, reality TV has revolutionized light entertainment. And now that celebrity is the currency of choice, the all-rounders are losing out to real people who have become the stars. Big Brother's first winner, Craig Phillips, was a builder who became a daytime presenter.
By putting a damp-proof membrane down, which is a sheet of polythene, directly onto the concrete.
Air steward Brian Dowling even replaced Anton Deck on SMTV.
You know, normal people would watch entertainers on the telly. Now, entertainers sit at home and watch normal people on the telly, you know. But my wife gets very rattled by all that. She goes, what can she do? What can they do? You know, why are you sitting at home? It's for my wife's sake, really, that I've got to get out there, you know.
Oh, you know, this job is getting more and more worthless because it seems that anyone can come in and do it. The good thing is, and I still stand by the fact that you may have been on a reality TV show and you may have become famous for a bit and you might have made quite a bit of money, but it depends how long you can manage to sustain it on the TV.
You know, there's some that Rebecca Lewis and all that, you know, oh, that moment with the pig.
Reality television is here to stay, and why not? Why television and the way of life has got to evolve. It has to do that.
So, for the all-rounders willing to risk 24-hour surveillance, there was a possible way back to TV stardom.
The lunatics are taking over this island.
For Joe Pasquale, who debuted 20 years before on New Faces, there was no looking back in 2004.
My agent phoned me and said, you fancy doing it? I went, no, no, tell them where to stick it. I don't want to go and do that. So I said, why not? I said, well, that's not what I do. I want to go on telly and be a comic. That's what I've done for 20 years.
Reality shows are either brilliant or they are absolutely the kiss of death.
So he said, well, look, there is no telly out there for what we do at the moment. He said, but if you go and do this, then and you're successful, then there would open up other doors for you to go back on the telly and do the stuff that you do.
Joe had been an attraction and remains one through his career, but in television terms, it brought him back into that TV eye.
He says, go out and do this. He said, whatever you do, he said, don't fart, don't lose your temper, don't scratch your nuts and don't swear. He said, if you don't do those four things, he said, you'll win. So I went out there, I didn't fart, I didn't scratch my nuts, I didn't swear, I didn't lose my temper, and I won. Expect the unexpected. That's all I can say.
Bring me sunshine.
Hard work keeping everybody happy.
In your smile.
I shall rise to the occasion.
Bring me laughter. All the while.
Danger's my middle name. Bastard. I feel like Leonardo DiCaprio in the Titanic. It was great just to have a wash around the Jacobs.
Jacobs?
Jacobs! Jacobs! It was amazing. Thank you. At the moment, it's gone ballistic. You know, I said it, I likened it to like going on holiday, on a crap holiday, and coming back as Elvis.
I'd like to be more myself than I'm going to be.
For Les Dennis, a celebrity Big Brother outing gave him the chance to star alongside Ricky Gervais in Extras and move from game show host to comic actor.
Ricky and Stephen said, how far can we go? And I said, go as far as you want, and if I don't like it, I'll tell you.
Save for later. Hey? We asked 100 people, which comedian is going to land on his feet and get his end away with an absolute cracker? You said Les Dennis, our survey said, ding, top answer, chubby bastard.
I'm in on the joke all the way through Extras and even wrote a couple of extra things in.
It's just that I've been doing a bit of thinking and I just don't think I can marry her. It's not fair. I mean, don't get me wrong.
Funny little swing.
Nothing wrong physically.
I'm sure.
The sex is extraordinary. Some of the stuff she dreams up.
What is that for?
She likes to video us, and we watch it back together, and sometimes I can't believe it's my arse going up and down. I'm getting excited just thinking about it.
Well, think about something else, then.
Look, if I can laugh at it, then I'm not this Les Miserable they'd called me for quite a while. Ooh, that's an original one. Les Miserable. So I think I proved that I was, you know, I was not this sad, lonely bloke that everybody thought I was.
I thought, if I do Big Brother,
The format's established, so they can only focus on me.
Well, I just arrived in town and I was wondering if there's any gay bars here.
And a few people said, are you sure? I said, well, I won't point the finger at anybody afterwards. If it all goes wrong, it goes wrong. I'm back where I'm started.
For Michael Barrymore, it was a chance to see if his career could be resurrected.
Oh, Michael.
Yep.
I would say it's probably one of the greatest experiences I've ever had as a person, as a human being, as therapy, because, you know, I used to pay for it and they paid me, which made a change, and as a performer. The buzz I have now on a daily basis is the best buzz without putting anything down my throat that I've ever had in my life. So I can't ask for more than that, you know? It's all extras.
Michael, you have finished second. Please leave the Big Brother house.
All performers have good times and bad times. They all have moments when everything looks bleak for them and then suddenly they get reborn. I mean, Forsyth, interestingly, got reborn by going on, Have I Got News For You?
60-odd years after his career began, Bruce Forsyth is back on top. Not so much a reinvention, but a reminder of just how good a game show host he is.
Play your Iraqi cards right. Ian, you go first.
Thank you, Bruce.
It's the king of clubs. Is that Ibram? Think about this. The audience will help you. Do you think it's higher or lower?
I'd say lower.
Now, what have you got? You've got the Eight of Hearts, Minister of Defence Sultan Hashim Ahmed.
I've been waiting 14 years for the show to be like this.
It was a chance to let people see that at 75 years old, you're not over the hill necessarily.
Within months, he was back on Saturday Night TV.
Keep going, you fool, I think is the first thing that comes to mind. I'm an entertainer, I'm a performer, I'm an all-rounder, I do so many things.
It's nice to twirl you, to twirl you.
And that's about all, really. I don't think there's anything else. I'm not too keen on doing any more game shows. And now
Macbeth spams. Arguably, today's best entertainers don't need a TV show to survive. But for those all-rounders who are prepared constantly to reinvent themselves, TV is there for the taking.
You've got some dirty apples.
The enjoyment, I have to say, every day of my life, I say thank you. I'm being part of light entertainment.
They haven't sussed me out yet. I'm being paid a fortune, and they like me. It doesn't get any better than this.
If you want to stay in this business, I think you have to adapt, and I don't think for one minute you should complain.
I still don't think I've achieved what I wanted to achieve. Not yet, and I'm still working on it.
I am very grateful, and I'm a lucky little devil. Thank you very, very much.
Next time on The Story of Light Entertainment, we'll reveal how radio and television have been involved in a non-stop battle for supremacy and the truth behind some of the casualties.
Radio is the mother of television, and they're still looking for the father.
You can't underestimate how important radio has been in the development of British comedy.
If you've got anybody hailing Chris Evans as a genius, you've got something very wrong with the world.
He should have been a big, big star.
And then it all fell apart.
It's very easy to go nuts.
It's a bugger of a business, this, when it goes wrong.